There we go.
Red dot.
Okay. Okay, welcome everybody to the big crowd. See, the video doesn't know. You're all packed in here today. It's a Trump rally. Okay, so anyway, what I was saying was, you know, I want maybe, you know, kind of like a little summary here and try and, I was thinking, I've been teaching the same thing for 6 years, but each time it was kind of like packaged in new personal events, you know, and I look back over the talks on my website, you know, is that the whole history of my life is there, of what happened during the week, when I fell in the pond, or when I got hit by, you know, when I had the most latest one was getting rear-ended, you know. But all the little, my uncle, and the martini glasses, and all, you know, the Halloween, everything that happened, you know, became basically a metaphor for turning within and awakening insight. You know, the whole... So the whole teaching that I'm discovering is that the external world and my internal world is the same world, but the unawakened mind sees it as two worlds, with me against the world. So I'm always in resistance. I broke my arm, the car hit me, you know, and I'm getting old, you know, all this stuff, you know, there's a resistance to it. From the big things to the cat pooped on the floor, you know, to the shouldn't have happened, you know, the whole that little resistance, you know, that if you had your brain wired, the mind would be going like, like this, you know. And all these little nervous system spikes, which come from resistance, this shouldn't have happened, you know, add up, you know, in the body, in the face, and the aging, and the whole thing, you know. So this whole practice is to get here. And you say, well, how boring that is, you know. Well, not at all. It's just that you treat the ups and downs with equanimity, so that your being is always at rest and at peace, even though the world may be spiking on you, you know. So that whatever happens then becomes your friend, you know, and not your enemy. So I think that to me that was the basic point, that when you and so in Christianity we call this the kingdom of heaven, you know, in other words, what heaven would be a peaceful place. Well, then our life in the world would be a peaceful place. So then the question is, you know, how do you get there? And then the other aspect of this teaching is that there's no path to it. There's no path or no means, and yet there is not a path. So the other aspect of this teaching that's kind of paradoxical, confusing, is that if we are already and always at peace, but I'm not experiencing it, then I want to do something in order to get to it. So now we have peace as future. So the idea, well, what do I have to meditate, and I got to go to classes, and I got to do these studies, I got to do something to get to this promise of peace in my time, because I'm not experiencing it now, so I got to get to it. And yet the teaching says, well, there's no way to get to it because it's already now. So that's like a Zen koan, you know. Hello, hello. So that's kind of like a, you know, that to me, that's Zen Buddhism. That's the paradox of Zen, is that it's this and it's not this, but you got to choose. Whoa, you know, you can't choose. So, but you have to choose. So anyway, so there's a So I think what I've been doing here has been trying to look at this problem from different angles, but from my everyday experience, which you all can share, because everyday experience is the same. You know, everybody falls down, and everybody has a cat that poops on the floor, and everybody has, you know, everyday experiences. So it's everyday mind that we can find the key to this paradox. You know, that's why Zen says everyday mind. What's enlightenment? Well, everyday mind is enlightenment. So everyday mind is where we always begin and always end, you know. So it has to be in that we unlock the key to this mystery of how to have peace in my time. That's a good phrase right there. You know, we're Chamberlain. And we came back from talking to Hitler. Peace in our time, right? Peace in our time. And the problem with this question or statement is the problem we all have with peace, is that we'll say, well, how can we get world peace, or how can we, well, it's always talking about we. But it's like we have to have peace as a group, as humanity. We have to have if we're going to get to heaven, we have to go as a group. We have to go as a religion. We have, you know, in other words, and the we is an abstraction. I mean, there is no such thing as a we. I mean, have you ever seen a we walk around? I mean, there is, you know, it's an idea that we use to communicate a category. But it doesn't actually exist. So the only one that can have peace in their time is me. You know, I can have peace in my time. I can't. So there is no our time. It's my time. So in this practice, this mystical practice, I'll say, there is only one self. In other words, the awakened mind realizes, discovers, that there is only one me, or one self, but that has no boundaries. So, but this is not a intellectual discovery, it's not a conceptual discovery, it is a insight, or sudden dropping out of this idea that the world is two. There's me and the world. And when you work with this puzzle long enough, you will come to a point where the world and I come together, and there is just awareness of it. It's just the clarity that doesn't have any me versus it. And the great enlightened beings stay there all the time. The best we can do is to get glimpses of it. You know, to get, you know, because when you get an insight into something, there's always a transformative quality to it. So this whole practice, as I've been struggling with it and trying to share it, basically is a enlivened curiosity that keeps looking at this insolvable puzzle in my everyday life. So it's a constant, I know for me, it's always going on in the background, this curiosity. What does this mean? And So the teaching, which is called the Dharma, that one studies, when you get books and whatever, that creates a kind of like an intellectual map that you keep discovering in your everyday life, relationships, or whatever. Can you close the door with me? So this, so I think that's what I've been trying, one thing I've been trying to do is kind of like give a basic understanding of the worldview or the dharma or this truth of one world that gives meaning to and insight into the world we live in, which is two. But we just don't really understand how habituated and hypnotized we are by the worldview of our Western culture. I mean, we just assume, rock bottom, that I am in me somewhere and you are there and I and you are different, and that I and God is different, God and nature is different, and me and nature is different, you know, and all of this split, you know, into names, compartments, we, I, it, and so forth, you know, is necessary for making stuff and catching a bus, but it is not reality. You know, so reality is really one, but then we perceive it and experience it as two. So this teaching is going against the whole inertia of the world we assume is real. And it doesn't mean that the world that we're living in and talking in here, and LLI and Richmond and all that, you know, isn't a real world. But it's just not substantially real. And all the mystical teachings keep pointing to that, and that's what they call it. The world's an illusion and all that, you know, it's not real. Well, it's real and it's not real. Which again brings you to this puzzle. So I was thinking too about today was the other thing that we've been working with over this class time is the tale, because I talk a lot about our, you know, America and our politics and about the worldview that we live in and how can we make sense out of it. And so it's really, if you remember the Tale of Two Cities, well, I was thinking about, I've been talking about the Tale of Two Stories. And in America, Western world, we live in a tale of two stories. One story is what I'll call secular humanism. And the other story is biblical. And I really first became aware of these two stories when I met my sister-in-law back in the around 2000, and she and my wife's sister, my wife's brother and her wife, and they became evangelicals, and that was the first time I really got to know the foundational biblical view of reality that is in constant conflict with the secular humanism, and you could say liberal, and you could say here would be conservative. Okay, so these two things have kind of like all got mixed up together, but the basic two stories, it all goes back to the Greeks and the Hebrews. I mean, it goes all the way back to Greek science and religion and the worldview of the Greeks and the worldview of the biblical worldview, you know, which would be there. So there's two stories here. We all know the biblical story, if you just read Genesis, you know, there's a story of the world. And the story tells us who we are, why we're here. So this still tells us why. This story here tells us why we're here, the meaning of why we're here. And this story over here basically tells us how we're here. So you want to know how we're here, well then evolution, you know, all this science, you know, all that you see. Rational, reasonable. And here, but it doesn't tell you why we're here. Well, it's just an accident. You know, some atoms hit together and boom, here we are, you see. So there's no real meaning here. So values are over here. And science is technology. And we can see these two stories at war all the time, you know, in our politics and everywhere. And, you know, just comes up everywhere. This conflict between who am I or what am I, you know? And so we'll choose one or the other, but we can't put them together.
Why?
Huh?
Explain why.
Well, we can't put them together because they really are opposite.
Because I feel like I live with them together.
Yeah.
For me.
Yeah.
Not what I think, but for me.
Well, they don't go together because this one is based on belief, and this one is based on evidence. So right away, I mean, you see the conflict there between evolution and creationism. That is the one of the. There are many different. Let's say fault lines in this conflict between two stories. One of them is evolution creation. Each side will adamantly say the other one is right, or I'm right and you're wrong. And then some people will make compromises and come up with ways of saying, well, maybe God created the Big Bang, and then let, you know. In other words, they try to put them together in different ways, you know. But the majority of the society divides into two camps. And so this division between these two stories kind of like keeps getting morphing into different conflicts, you know, abortion and not abortion, even in politics with the conservatives and liberals. And everything that seems to happen today will immediately, you'll have some event here, and it will immediately divide into two ways of looking at it. You know, in other words, every event that is given, if there's just a little bit of ambiguity in something, if there's something that happens that's ambiguous, something, if anything's the slightest bit, it'll immediately divide into two contradictory views. The same fact will have two different views, and they'll go to war with each other. And then that will keep morphing into and drawing more. So you get this, one of my favorite symbols is the Ouroboros. I can't even draw it. Okay? And this is like when these two views meet, it's kind of like they meet in the warm Atlantic. The water's warm, and you get these two winds meeting, and they immediately begin to circle each other, and that draws in, see, it creates a vortex, or maybe the whirlpool, right? See, this is moving like this, see? This is moving, and these two opposing stories start the other one and come up with the one story that explains everything, right? Now you got two stories that explain everything oppositely. So they go like this so that there's only one story left. Because you only have one truth. You can't have two truths. So they eat each other, trying to become one, and this sucks in energy. So now you have the internet, which is kind of like the warm ocean of the Atlantic. And so when one of these little storms start, it soon begins to suck energy in from the whole internet, you see. And now you've got a tiny little tropical storm into a huge Category 7 hurricane. Yeah.
I wonder what she's saying when she says that she lives with it every day together.
For me? Well, the world, I mean.
So we can, I mean, the whole, if we look, you know, if we look at it as a matter, if you look at the America or the world, but particularly America now, since, you know, every day there's a new little breeze or new little swirling depression, a new little depression, and in time you can watch it grow. More people, you know, because right now you see there's a little depression about whether the Russians hacked the election. You know, okay, well, right away you can say one says, well, they didn't, and the other one says they did. So, well, right away, now that's going to draw in energy for each side. So now each side will call in the energy support its side, you see. And so now you'll end up with a all-consuming, and you can watch it happen on the media, you know.
And what is the best way not to get sucked into that? What is the best
Okay, well, see, what I've been trying to do is to translate this. Now, this is an external view of an internal event.
Right.
So the internal event, you see, so if I can understand it in my everyday mind, I won't fall into the, I won't get sucked into this thing. I mean, I can't change it, but I can prevent myself from being sucked into it. I can, what I want to do is understand it and not fight for the one story that I believe is true. See, if I get sucked into this, well, then I'm going to go to war against the other view, saying I'm right and you're wrong, and I'll fight to the death, you see, until there's just one story and it's mine. So this is an external metaphor for my own mind. So what I need to do now in this practice is understand and see and notice when this is happening in me, in my everyday mind. So that I can notice this happening whenever a monologue starts in my mind. So I had a little monologue starting here. So I'm getting ready to come to the come here today. It began maybe yesterday because I knew I was getting ready to come to class, and I was going to go into the administration, you see, and find out where and ask them why they didn't want me to come. You know, was there a problem, or was it just the fact that nobody signed up, or did I do something wrong, or you know what? You know, the question of why they sent me the email. That I wouldn't have a class this time was ambiguous. So I did. So there was a little bit of ambiguity there, right? So this created a monologue. So now the monologue goes on in the mind, where now I'm having imaginary conversations with the administration. That's what a monologue. You have imaginary talks with either somebody you're going to confront or somebody you did confront and didn't have a satisfactory conclusion to it, right? Or an imaginary person, or yourself. But it's with somebody. And a monologue is the thought eating itself. It doesn't stop, you know. And it can, if you don't understand it, it can become a panic. I mean, it can grow. We all experience that, you know. Now you've got to take something. Give me some medication to stop it, you see. Now I got a worry mind, I got a worry thing, you know. So right there, you see, that little monologue can start off as a little teeny tropical depression, and unless you can incorporate it in your practice, it's going to grow. Yeah.
I think when I look at why I came to this class in the first place,
yeah,
I think part of it is that I was a scientist, and my wife is really a religious background, and I find myself looking at evidence, and there, when you go to the evidence, I have to be in the middle of the two, because you can't find enough evidence to buy into the other side. And it always strikes me as remarkable that so much of our population believes so strongly in one side or the other,
yeah,
without real evidence. How can you believe that you're correct when so much of the rest of the population thinks your evidence isn't right? And I hoped, and I think I am getting this a little bit, to simply accept that there are two sides. Nobody really has the answers. What's going to happen is going to happen, period.
Well, let's stop right there. I'm glad you brought that up, because you did bring me to the next step here, which was when you notice. Now, this is where mindfulness, the practice of mindfulness, comes in, where you have a practice of meditation, where you practice intentionally just to sit and be aware of the mind without running with it. So you're aware of thinking is stories. Thinking happens in stories. So you're aware of the stories that thinking is creating. You notice it there, but you don't identify with it and go running. If you do, you come back. So you're constantly creating an awareness that notices when a story is being created. Okay? It doesn't have any, it's not judgmental, the story's wrong or not. You just notice there's a story. And so the noticing is that you're not, that I'm not the story. Okay, so this is, at that point, you can notice that a story is happening, a monologue is happening in your mind. And the monologue happens because there's a conflict that you can't choose your way out of. You can't choose one or the other, because they are both, when you divide the one into two, you can't get back to the one by just choosing one or the other. In other words, when we talk a lot about now, the present moment, you know, be present, be now, you know, be here now, all that stuff, basically is not being in conflict with now.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, this moment is one. I mean, we're all here in this moment, one, and it's not divided into two moments. It's not, you know, in other words, the oneness cannot be divided, but the mind does divide it. So, when the mind divides one, and you end up in a little monologue, it's basically thinking is trying to get back to the one before it was divided. So if I got a little monologue going on, oh, I got to go talk to the administration, and are they going to find fault with me or not, or, you know, not imaginary little conflict here, you see, my peace has been destroyed. So I want to get back to my peace or my oneness, you see, through thinking. You see, so that's the first stop. So then the way that what you were suggesting, what you do next then, is that you notice the monologue going on, oh, there it is, and you say, okay. I'm okay with it, I'm not that. So as soon as you say, I'm okay with it, you stop the monologue is painful. Because it splits me. It splits my mind into two parts, each trying to become the one. You see, so the or wants to be the one, and the either wants to be the one. But it's either or. You have two, you see, that's grown out of the one, and we want to get back to the one through thinking, which can only choose either one or the other. Thinking can't be both. Thinking can't be either and or. Thinking can't be good and bad. In other words, a person can't be, anything can't be good, bad. Everything has to be good or bad. It's got to be hot or cool. It can't be hot, cool. Or it can be up or down, but it can't be up, down. Yeah.
I think also that, like in my own instances, I have to pick a unique topic to ask yay or nay. You know, I feel very strongly about this topic.
Right.
And I'm kind of vague about that one.
Right.
And like with regard to religion, I feel guilty for not saying, well, I believe God the Father Almighty, but when I need him, I'm right there praying for help. Because I'm scared that,
right.
I don't want to offend, you know,
yeah,
the
might
most
be wrong.
Powerful force.
Well, let me work on that just for a second. I think what we're essentially getting to the point here is that life is ambiguous. So, but the mind wants to have certainty, and the problem with ambiguity is that it's not certain. Okay, it's this or that. I don't know, right? It's yin or yang. I don't know which one it is. You know, in other words, it holds both. I was just watching yesterday on the Globe Tracker, and they were going to China and discovering Cantonese cooking. And Cantonese cooking is basically yin-yang cooking. Everything is balanced. Hot, cool, the whole thing is balanced. So it's a spiritual cooking. You see, that made it so famous, because it balances. It's not hot or cold. It balances the yin and the yang. So the balance of the yin and the yang is where you're okay with ambiguity. In other words, you don't try to separate the ambiguity into this has got to be just hot food or cool, you know what I mean. You don't try to separate the good from the bad. You don't try to separate the opposites. You allow the opposites to be there. And when you allow the opposites to be there, something new arises that restores unity. So the unity is restored out of the allowing the ambiguity to be there. So if I've got a monologue going about some confrontation I'm going to have or I did have that I didn't resolve, or whatever, you see, I have created a little Ouroboros in my mind, where the mind is trying to eat itself in order to bring peace to itself. In other words, it tries to consume itself through thinking, where the two opposites try to restore one by getting rid of the other one, which can't be done, all right? Because neither one of these opposites is the whole thing, you see. So the only way out, you see, is to notice it. And then I'm okay with not knowing. You see, the whole point of the conflict here is that we have, in America today, is that there is a lost certainty. There's a lost certainty about who we are. Is America great or is it not great? You know, whatever. What's our role? Who we, you know, everything's in flux. So there's a lost certainty. And you can't live without certainty. Mm-hmm. Certainty means you know the one, or I know what reality is, you know. So we're not comfortable with uncertainty. So this is why you get the conflict between these two stories, is that the biblical conservative view is certain that it has this one story that explains everything, and the other one view is certain that it has the story that explains everything. You see, so you have but you have two realities here. And this creates a tremendous neurotic, schizophrenic tension in our country. So I really think we are a collective schizophrenic.
Yeah, it's interesting.
You know, in that sense, because the schizophrenic has a divided psyche. Doesn't know what, you know, this voice is telling me this and this one's telling me that. I don't, you know, which one is the truth, you see. So we have all these voices, you know, talking to us through media, and what we want is, well, which one is the truth, you see. So this is creating this collective schizophrenia. But getting back to our my own personal schizophrenia, you see, which would be when I get caught up in two voices. A monologue would be an argument going on in my head trying to resolve itself, you see. I should do this, or no, you shouldn't, you know, you're right, you know, yada yada, you know that. So the way out to restore unity is to say, I don't know what the truth, I don't know. And I'm okay with not knowing. And as soon as we see, the not knowing restores unity. If you have to know one or the other, now you're creating the Ouroboros that becomes the hurricane, you know, the panic attack. That sweeps up everything, sweeps up people, you know.
It was beautiful what you said. It's almost like saying, be comfortable with not knowing.
Yeah.
And time will reveal which way to go.
Yeah.
If it is that way.
Yeah.
Another example that came to my mind is it's like a seed sprouting, right?
Yeah.
Seed has to sprout. You have to see the plant. It's okay. Be patient. When the time is right, it will show.
Yeah, that's a good analogy, is that the not knowing is the soil out of which the seed of knowing will grow.
Oh, that's a beautiful. I like
okay,
that.
So when you, and this is, we experience this all the
it's
time.
It's the dark matter.
Yeah, this we experience this all the time, but we don't really recognize it in the context of this because all the great romantic stories, you know, in the movies and everything, is the should I choose this one or that one? You know, I don't know. You know, and so suddenly one day you wake up and know. So the whole movie is about the knowing. That this is the right one. And they go running together, you see, because they know. There's no more, oh, should this one or that one, you see. There's no more monologue, no more division, no more a conflict, you know, I know.
Until they know.
We all know this. Knowing restores unity. So when we believe with every fiber in our body that the biblical story, and I'm not getting into this right or wrong, but if I believe this, then I have restored certainty. But now I'm in conflict with this, you see. So now this becomes an enemy to this. And if I'm here, then this side becomes an enemy to this, you see, because it's all coming out of the same one, you see. So you can't have any, that's why you know that if this is your one reality, then anybody believing this story is an existential threat, you see, that has to be either converted or removed. And same with this side, you know. So these two are looking at the other stories, you see, as existential threats to their oneness, their certainty. So the one thing we don't want to lose, you see, is certainty that I know what's real and what's not real. Because I fear, the fear of uncertainty is the fear of chaos and losing control and psychosis, you know, and madness, you know. So there's always this lurking shadow of psychosis under everything, where you fall into this void, you know, where you don't know who you are, you don't know anything, you know, and you end up in the mental ward, you know, or Alzheimer's, you know, that kind of, which is a metaphor for not knowing who you are. So it all really begins, basically, the whole thing, the whole story here really begins with being able to be at ease and at rest with the first indications of the little split, you know. So that was being okay with the monologue means that you are not the monologue. There's one there and it's okay, but I'm not that. So I'm okay that it's there, and that maintains my center. That maintains my peace. As soon as I forget and try to restore peace, which I already have, you see how that, if I'm already at peace, and now I experience not peace because my mind is divided into an either or conflict, and now I've got to restore peace, you see, through thinking, I have already separated body and mind. So the original mind as one, you know. So when body and mind is one, I feel at peace. That's why we love hobbies and sports, whatever, because when we do a craft or a hobby or something that's interesting that we're passionately involved with, we're one with it. You see? The body's doing it and the mind's doing it as one being. And I feel centered and I feel at peace with myself and with life, you know. But then when I can't do that and I have to go back into marriage or go back somewhere else, now I'm split, you see, and the old conflict comes back up and I want to get back to my peace, but I can't now through effort, you see, now because now I put peace off in the future. Now I've got to get to it, you see, and it's always now. So as soon as we get into a monologue, we separate the mind from the body and begin to live in the mind. And the mind has gotten to go in a self-consuming circle of thinking, which consumes everything. You know, so when you create that in a social fabric, as we said, you can see the energy. Or just look at a high school. I remember the most. You go to a high school during the day, you know, and there's a little argument gets started in the hall, and the next thing you know, you got one of these things going. And now you've got a fight, and then that just draws every kid in the school will come running, you know, to circle around this Ouroboros, you know, which consumes everything, you know. And you can just see it everywhere happening like that, you know, that it draws, just like a hurricane in the Atlantic, it draws all the energy in the area into that storm, so it goes around and around and around, getting bigger and bigger and bigger. That's a metaphor for our mind. And so this practice basically is saying, wait. So when you notice the depression happening, immediately you can say, wait, you know, pause, you know. What's the truth here? I don't know what the truth is. See, I don't know what the truth
is. Is that the question you want to ask?
Yes.
Is it?
You say you don't know. I don't. When the monologue gets started, if I say I know what the truth is, it's got to be one or the other. But if I say I don't know.
But I mean,
know,
are you seeking truth?
Well, truth would be certain. Would be oneness.
Right.
Would be peace.
Okay.
In other words.
Okay. So
truth. See, we even that word is screwed up.
Right. Exactly.
But see, in truth, truth means it's not divided. You can't have two truths. Or then you get back to something, you know, now you get back into the Civil War, you see. So truth means one. The whole truth and nothing but the truth means one that is not without a second. We define God that way. God is the one without a second. You're not two gods. You know, unless you get into a theological problem and you have to have a devil. You have to have a devil in order to make sure God is pure. And if you say God is perfectly good, well, then how do you get evil? Well, we got to create a little sub-God here to do the evil because our God didn't do it.
But when you define truth, you define truth within a specific population. I mean, a population thinks this is the truth. Another population says, this is the truth.
Well, truth is always going to be a story.
Yeah.
Because information by itself is meaningless. It's just like it's just like snowflakes. You know, it's just data. So you have to have a story in order for the data to have a integration and a reference to something. Well, the story holds the data together. So even the liberal humanistic secular view is a story of reality. It was created after the Middle Ages. You know, so that the story of the Enlightenment would, you know, and so, you know, so it's a story of reality in the same way that the biblical view is a story of reality. So depending on which the facts that come, the data that comes in is either going to make sense in this view or that one, you see. But it's just, you know, so either one, if these are the only two stories, all the data, which is new stuff, new information, is going to come into one or the other worldviews. But the Buddha worldview, or the mystical worldview that we've been working with here, is neither of these, you see. So it puts them together, because the external world, as I just demonstrated, the external world of conflicts in society is a metaphor for the conflict in my own mind. So if I can, the source is my mind, so if I can begin to understand it in my mind, I can understand it in the world, because it's the same laws. You know, in other words, science, I was just saying, I was watching this new documentary on Mars, where the, you know, it's a future, you know, they got, it's a combination of current status on going to Mars, and then it was a fictitious landing on Mars, how it would be like and all that. And one thing that stuck in my mind was that the science that we've discovered on Earth works on Mars. Or as far as you can go in the universe, the same science works. Right? So that's the science of this view here.
Excuse me.
So so this science here kind of like explains everything, because no matter how far you can go, it's going to explain it. At least that's the assumption. But anyway, I forgot the other thought, was that the original, let's talk about the original sin, you could say, what is the original source? It's of sin. It's not Obama. Or Clinton. But the original sin is from the Buddha view, is the separation of body and mind.
Yeah.
And that begins in childhood, you know, because the early childhood is body-mind. And then the mind begins to separate and be culturized by society, which is natural. And the child begins to get names for everything, and he names himself. I'm Ed, you know, and I'm 5 years old, you see that? You know, and so I begin to have an identity, and I ask Mom what everything is, and that's good, that's bad, oh, that's good. But don't play with it, the knife's bad, you know, and all that stuff, you know. So we begin to categorize the world into good and bad, into a dual world. And this is fine, because you have to be able to catch a bus and get a job and do stuff, yeah.
So one of the things that might be helpful here, and I think would be, of course, truth is oneness, no split. This is what you said. But in life, I think we all are making choices. We are making choices.
Yeah, yeah.
Nothing is perfect. Should I work in this company versus that company? Nothing is perfect. Should I commute? Not commute.
Right.
Marriage? No marriage. Whatever.
Yeah.
Nothing is perfect. The question is how to make a decision.
Yeah.
The truth, it's not going to be ever black and white, go this way. How do you make a decision? So one of the things that I had learned was, it's like your soul knows what is the right thing for you at that moment. And so if you put both the scenarios, A versus B, whichever is peaceful, I'm not saying, or it heart will indicate what is the right decision. Does that make sense?
Yes. We're basically, how do I get back to
unity?
If the original sin that starts the depression,
yep,
monologue,
mm-hmm,
is when the mind separates from the body,
right,
and I begin to live in thinking,
right,
and thinking is going to be dualistic.
Right.
Thinking works either or. Okay, so when I'm in thinking, I'm in a dualistic world, which basically says I'm here and there's there, and I got to choose the right one. So we're always kind of like here with thinking. What should I do? Well, I remember when back in 1968, and I had it was an awakening, but I knew that I had awakened a tiger of this energy, And I needed to find, and I didn't know what to do with it. So I went to see, got on my motorcycle, and I went up to Swannanoa. And Swannanoa was the home of Walter Russell, who had recently passed away, but he was a Renaissance man, like Jefferson, in the sense that he knew it. He was in all kinds of different sciences, you know, writer, philosopher, everything. And he lived on a mansion, Swannanoa. There were Greek statues all around in the head. And his wife, forgot her name, was still there, and she was a meditation teacher, whatever. So I went up there to meet the, that was the closest guru I could find, you know. So I went up there, and I was going to see the, I'm sitting in there, and she comes down the stairs and asked to talk with her, and I said, you know, I told her what had happened. I didn't know what to do. She said, well, if you don't know what to do, don't do anything. And then left, and that was it, you know. So that one thing right there, if I'm caught in here, you see, I have to accept that I don't know.
Correct.
And be okay with that.
Correct.
Okay, so it's being the okay with not knowing that is the hardest thing, because the ego must know.
Well, in my life, I consider not knowing usually the highest form of consciousness that I have attained.
Yeah.
When I can say, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm at my peak.
Right.
Also, something else you said, I'm at my peak. And so for me, the decision process, well, that's a lie. I wish always the decision process was, when I'm at a crossroads, is to sit.
Right.
Or do nothing, or meditate, or
right.
whatever. But I go into the, the whole thing too. I'm not
sure.
special. But it's such a wonderful, wonderful way of looking at it. And in the past election has been wonderful for that. It's really just all over the everywhere. And one of the things I learned is that, gee, there are a group of people, I would have never ever known this. There are a group of people, or there will always be a group of people, who can take what I consider to be facts. If we're talking about the climate change, if we're talking about facts coming from people who study that stuff, and who, because they can say, for whatever reason, I don't believe that. No facts to put back that up, just that I don't believe it. And be okay with that.
Yeah.
That, not that I accept that or anything for my way of looking at that subject, but gee, what a remark, not that I agree with it, but what a remarkable way, what a bullish way to live. I just never had thought about saying,
you know,
I don't believe that.
I thought about this the other day. Now,
it's incredible.
One thing in the religious view, I remember reading somewhere, I believe because it's absurd. Or it's the idea that the death and resurrection of Jesus, you know, and all that is kind of like impossible. In other words, the whole, you know, scientific, you know, it's, in other words, but I believe it because it's absurd, you know, because, and so the more, you know, so this whole idea here is that a belief in certainty can be strengthened if what you believe in is totally absurd.
Exactly.
Now, I think conspiracy theories
exactly.
are great examples of this, because some of them believe in totally absurd theories, but they hold on to it for dear life because their belief in it makes them special, makes them certain.
I totally get that.
See what I mean? So I believe I don't care if the whole world's wrong.
Right.
I hold my ground, you see. So the more they hold the ground, the stronger their center is. And if they were just to relax a little bit and say, well, maybe, you know, the whole thing would start coming down. You know, so they can't afford doubt. Doubt cannot come into this at all, you see. But the whole Zen way is to invite doubt. So doubt is when you I don't know which one is that. So that's the doubt. I don't know.
Right.
You know, so you invite, it's called the great doubt.
Oh, you know, I didn't know that.
Yeah, so in Zen it's called the great doubt. I mean, it's kind of like, there are little things you can, you know, run into, but the great doubt is, who am I? And so there is a story of Bodhidharma, who brought Buddhism to China, Zen Buddhism. Buddhism was already established in China, but not the Zen Buddhism. So Bodhidharma came, and he met this emperor, Wu, who was already built monasteries and temples, and he thought he'd done a great job. And he asked Bodhidharma if these works meant anything. You know, all this work, and he said, not a thing. There's no won't mean a thing. And then the emperor said, well, who are you? And Bodhidharma says, I don't know. And left, you know. And so when he left, the emperor's aide said, who was that? And the emperor says, I don't know. Now, there are two I don't knows here, but they're different meanings. When the emperor says, I don't know who that is, there's the assumption that if I had enough time and a little more information, I would know who that was.
Label him.
Yeah, in other words, I need a little more information here to know who he is. When Bodhidharma says, I don't know who I am, he was not saying, I need a little more time. You see, he was right here.
Right.
You know, I'm not this or that. Because once you say I'm one thing, there's also what it's not.
Right, right.
If I say this one thing here, well, this is one thing here because it's not a chair. It's not something else, you see. So as soon as I select something, I have also made it one thing, but I've made it dependent upon everything it's not, you see. So there are really two things, what it's not and what it is. But the only way out of that is to not know what it is. But this, we don't want to go there. But when we do really go there, it becomes a portal. It becomes a door opens.
All possibility opens. And that's what I mean, T. Mm-hmm. How do you live with those two things always going on? Everything. I'm sorry.
I'm glad, you know, we're working here. What I've discovered happens, the way I interpret this, is when you're okay with not knowing whether it's this or that, and you're really okay with it, that initiates the creative response.
Exactly.
A creative answer. And a creative answer is one that hasn't happened before. So you suddenly know something that you didn't know before, because the creative answer combines the split and creates one that includes the two, but in a new way. And you can't get to the new way unless you surrender trying to pick one or the other. So this surrender to the dualism creates the non-duality of a creative insight or creative response, or on the higher end, you know, a totally new being, which is you see. Yeah, and that would be, the way I translate that is the real resurrection.
Exactly.
There's the dying to the duality of the world.
Exactly.
I don't know, and out of the I don't know, an insight or a knowing or a new way of being in the world is resurrected, you see. So all of the stuff that's externally given to us in the stories, you see, everything, Joseph Campbell says, everything is a metaphor.
It is.
Everything is a metaphor that points to your own awakening, you see. Yeah, you were at some...
No, I think when you think conservative versus liberal, I think the conservative is very, a real conservative is unlikely to change their mind, period. Whereas the definition of a liberal is that they may be swayed toward some conservative views because they're liberal.
Well, look at the two. See, this is where the culture has been talking about separation of church and state. No, they're one, on one side anyway. Because if the liberal base is in science, well, science basically exists to be proven not true.
Right.
And religious belief exists to always be true. So that's where the religious beliefs gives you a certainty that cannot be destroyed. That's why the church looks like a fortress. A lot of churches are built like a little medieval castle. Mm-hmm. You know, so it cannot be. You know, it becomes a castle. You can't destroy. And this is fine. I'm not saying this, but it's the whole idea that that this certainty cannot be destroyed. Well, the problem is that this certainty is placed in the external world. So it becomes certain about my story about the external world, you see. And in the Buddha view, everything is impermanent. So all these stories, everything died. But you can't depend on anything out here. The only thing that's fixed is my being okay with not being fixed. See, that's the final frontier. That's the final fix. It's when you're fixed and being okay with not knowing, you're fixed. And that's your certainty. And out of that being willing to not be fixed in knowing what to do, you see, comes the restoration of the original oneness. And you just do what you do then. So then you just, whatever you do is okay then. You know, stay, leave, go to California, don't. Whatever you do is okay if you do it from this place of unity. But if you do it from here, what you didn't choose is going to haunt you. You see?
I would say, yeah, and it's really not, because there is definitely a path that, you know, we want to go on, because those are the lessons we need to learn or grow. So if you say, oh, either way is fine, well, it won't be, because that won't be teaching me those sense. And the specific example I can give you is 2 years back, I quit my job, a very high paying job, 20% more salary, I mean, in six figures and all that. And my soul was crying out, I do not want to take that job. At my age, whatever, people will say, are you nuts? And yet, that is what my soul was craving for. And I suffered through 2 years of that. And then again, this thing came and higher salary. I'm like, heck. Now, either if I had relaxed, oh, it's okay. Either way, it's fine. No, it was not okay. I said, wait till that definitive answer comes, which came after 2 years, where I'm like, I don't care what, I'm not going to go into corporate. And that, I have been so much happier, because there is so much of growth in me.
Well, here's the other, I'm glad you brought that up. Here's the other, when we... we're able to understand what's going on in the mind, the understanding is coming from something outside of the mind. In other words, when you're lost in the thinking, either or, you know, there's no understanding. Understanding always embraces the opposites. So the understanding is always when you see a whole that includes the either or that you were torn up by, you see. Suddenly understanding happens. So understanding is always transcendent of the immediate duality of either or, you see. So understanding is, but we don't get to the understanding unless we can surrender our identity and the need to know, which is a need for future. The need for future means that I got to do this or that in order to get to a better future.
Right. So
right?
Be patient.
But there is no future.
Be patient, release.
Right, see? But that means even being patient is assuming there's future. If I just wait, that's like the Emperor Wu. Well, if I just wait, I'll get more information and know who he is, you see. In other words, so the idea of be patient, it will pass, assumes that, well, you just exercise patience and this miserable situation will finally move on and you'll come to a good conclusion, you see. Well, that's not accepting the present moment. That's, you know, that's basically, I'll just be patient, you see. But it's got to pass. But this, I don't accept this. But if I'm patient, it'll pass. Well, that's, you know, kind of like an avoidance of the, this is kind of like an existential movement here. I mean, it's not something you can just choose.
It's like that snow globe, you know?
Yeah.
It's snow globe, which you showed us here in the class.
Yeah.
It's like, you have to be patient. I accept the moment. And it settles down, and that clears the reveals.
Well, see, even then, you see, this is so difficult to get a grasp of that. If there is this either-or choice is future-orientated, okay, and being okay with it is no choice.
And no future, right?
There's no, if I'm okay with it, that means I'm okay with right now. I don't want it to be different. I don't have to wait for it to get to be different. I don't have to do something to make it different. I don't have to resist it at all. So there is no resistance in being okay with what is happening right now, you see. And if my mind starts to resist what's happening, which it's going to do, my okay awareness notices that. And in the noticing of it, I'm okay with it. If I don't notice it, I'm in it. Right. And I'm getting sucked into it. Now I'm angry, and why they do that, and this shouldn't happen, and all that, I'm afraid, and all that, you see. But if I can catch it at the insemination, I can abort that thing. Use
that bad language for this. He just blew a mind out.
Yeah, well, you know,
but they're not in here anyway.
Yeah, in other words, that you know, that this little. This little depression, you see, if we don't catch it there, it's kind of like the roller coaster. We go to an amusement park, and when that car comes down, if I don't see the car, and I don't see the, I know if I get in that, I'm going to throw up. You know, if I get in that thing, I can't get off until it runs around the whole thing, and then I get off and say, I'll never get on that again. But then it comes around again, and I forget, because it's a new car, and everybody says, oh, this is great. And I get in it, and then this is the same old ride. That's karma.
Yeah.
You know, it's an inert. Once you get in it, you can't get off of it until it runs its course. Yeah. And then you're thrown back out in the into the now, and you're all beat up. You know, say, wow, I won't go with that person again. Why did I do that? You know, or it's the same old sister-in-law, or the same old brother-in-law, or the same old argument. You know, every Thanksgiving we do it. You know, that kind of. And I vow never to do it again, and sure enough. But, you know, the whole karmic thing, you see, is a life lived separated from the now. And the body is now. Our bodies are always now. That's where the body lives. But when we live in the mind, which is our culture, is a mind culture, it lives separated from the body. And we have to go to yoga class in order to find it again. This is your body. How do you like, you know? Well, I haven't known you for a long time. You know what I mean? It's kind of like bringing back a married couple, you know? And just everything divides like that, you know? You could say the feminine side is associated with the body, and the masculine side is associated with the mind, you know? And so then you get of people split up, you know, into all these different things, you know. But you can, you know, keep peeling the onion back until you get back down to my original sin, which would be thinking that I can choose my way out of unhappiness. You see. Which is basically the future thinking is future oriented. So this really is not a choice, because the choice would be up here, you see. So being okay with something comes spontaneously when you see the futility of trying to choose your way out of it. So when you understand that you can't choose peace, the fruit falls from the tree, and you suddenly are at peace. And when you are at peace, a new understanding or knowing rises, you see, out of the ashes of this trying to choose your way out of it. But you see, our whole culture says you have to choose. Mm-hmm. You can't just sit there. And if you don't know, you're kind of like shamed. You have to have an opinion, you know. You have to have a belief or an opinion. You have to have principles, you know. This is where Trump is totally confusing everyone, because he has no principles. He's totally pragmatic. He just whatever I choose right now is the right thing, you know. So it creates a tremendous amount of fear and uncertainty. All right, let's have some cupcakes.
All right.
Hey.
Thank you.
Best class I've ever.
Thank you so much. Well, this will be on my the last one on the my website.
I have a present for you. I made it.